and welcome to the Penguin Prof channel. Is this you studying the nervous system and the action potential? Yeah, it's pretty severe, I know, but don't worry. We've got the action potential and those voltage-gated channels today. So here we are, basic neuron function. We have the arrival of a stimulus. It says go. We reach threshold at the axon hillock, and we have an action potential. And that electrochemical signal will spread down the axon, arriving at the axon terminal. We get the release of neurocrines across the synapse, binding to a receptor, signal transduction, resulting in a cellular response. If you want to see more about that, check out Know Your Neurons. But today I want to talk about that language of the nervous system. What is the action potential? The polarity across the membrane is just like a battery. So don't worry, we're going to go there. Phospholipid bilayer separates the extracellular fluid, the ECF, from the intracellular fluid, the ICF. Now, if you throw a voltmeter across that membrane, you're going to measure an electric potential difference of minus 70 millivolts inside negative. Just like a battery separates charge, so does the membrane. We've got that 3-sodium-2-potassium pump. Every time an ATP gets hydrolyzed, 3 ions of sodium get pumped out, while 2 ions of potassium get pumped in. And we also have potassium leak channels, allowing potassium to flow down their gradient. So this is the setup for these 2 ions. And this is rest. It is not an equilibrium, to be sure. Sodium wants to come in, potassium wants to go out. And if you want to know why the ions want to do that, here's a video for you. So this is going to be about the magic of those voltage-gated channels. They hold the key. We're going to look at the voltage-gated sodium channel and then the voltage-gated potassium channel. So let's look at the voltage-gated sodium channel first. It has a couple of really interesting features, including these voltage-sensitive rods with arginine residues, also some lysine. These are called gating arginines, or rapid activation gates. And to understand how they work, yeah, you guessed it, we're going to look at the chemistry. Here's arginine, here's lysine, and notice they are both positively charged. That's the key. So when you put them in an electric field, they're going to be attracted to the opposite charge and repulsed by a similar charge. So they move through this electric field. If you attach things to them, like little weights, aren't they cute? This is actually, of course, part of the protein, they will drag those things right along with them. And that's what they do in the membrane. So the rapid activation gates, we strip away everything else. Watch the membrane polarity. So when the membrane polarity switches, they move and they drag parts of the protein with them, and it opens a pore or a channel through which sodium can pass. It is so cool. But wait, there's more. This little guy in yellow is called a slow inactivation gate, and it wants to bind to a spot that we can't really see right now because it's being covered up by part of those rapid activation gates. But keep an eye on it because it's going to play a major part in the action potential. All right, let's do it. So we're going to start at rest, minus 70 millivolts. Now, if you find my explanations helpful, could you please take a second and click some buttons below? Please just click something. I really appreciate it. This is minus 70 millivolts at rest. And here we go, minus 60. You see those arginine rods start to move, but nothing yet. Not until we reach threshold. At minus 50 millivolts, they move enough to expose this channel. And now, as far as sodium is concerned, it's good times. They can move through this channel in the direction they want to go, and watch the millivolts. Now we're at minus 40, now we're at minus 20, so sodium is moving in the direction it wants to go, bringing its positive charge with it and depolarizing the cell. Now, are you keeping an eye on this, the slow inactivation gate? Because it's on the move. And here we are at 0 millivolts. Sodium keeps going. And here we are at now plus 30. And at this voltage, that slow inactivation gate finally gets to bind to that spot where it wants to, and it forms a plug. So even though sodium would like to continue to move in, it can't. So at plus 30, sodium influx stops. All right, so that's the voltage-gated sodium channel. The voltage-gated potassium channel works very much the same way. We have the same arginine rods. They're repulsed by positive charges and attracted to negative charges. So they are, in this configuration, at minus 70. They open at plus 30. So they are tweaked slightly differently, so they respond a little bit differently with membrane voltage, but the principles are the same. So at plus 30, they open a pore for potassium, and potassium floods out. As potassium floods out, it takes its positive charge with it. And now we see here at 0 millivolts, it's still flowing out. It's still flowing out at minus 40, at minus 70, and these gates close at minus 80. So at minus 80, potassium efflux stops. So now what we're going to do is go through the action potential, Penguin Prof style, and look at the gates, and hopefully everything makes sense. So here we are at the resting membrane potential. The voltage-gated sodium channels are closed. When threshold is reached, the sodium gates open because those arginine gates have now moved and that channel for sodium is exposed. The upsweep of the action potential is due to the influx of sodium. At the peak of the action potential, those slow inactivation gates form a plug, so sodium flow stops, and those voltage-gated potassium channels open. So the downsweep of the action potential, the repolarization, is due to the efflux of potassium. Potassium leaves the cell, taking its positive charge with it. It actually keeps going, and we get hyperpolarization all the way down to minus 80, which is finally when the potassium gates close, and then we have a reset. Sodium gates are closed, potassium gates are closed, and we are back to resting membrane potential. And that is the end of the story, as well as this video. As always, I hope it was helpful. Thank you for visiting the Penguin Prof channel. Please click some of those buttons below, show your support, show the love, and I will see you in the next one. Good luck.